Before we actually get started here with the War Thunder video, I mean, I'm so happy somebody uploaded this cover that Sabaton did, because this song, Burn in Hell, a cover of a Twisted Sister song that Sabaton did, is only available, I believe, through a Japanese version of the album. So it's practically fucking impossible to get your hands on if you don't live in Japan or are not willing to spend about $3 million to get it. So, why is this only included on the Japanese version? I mean, why? In other news, we have a new dev blog for War Thunder to take a look at. Yes, I know I haven't been doing videos at all for the past few days. I just haven't done shit, and there's a few reasons for that, but I'm not going to go into detail here. This is a new aircraft that the British will be getting. One of the aircraft that I was actually a little bit interested in, one of the ones that we saw during the sneak peek, or for the sneak peek, which, by the way, apparently there is a teaser added for the sneak peek, and I took a look at it. There's nothing really there worth making a video about. That's why I didn't make a video about it. But let's go ahead and take a closer look at this new British aircraft that we will be getting in the game. So we got a video. This is my first time clicking into it. It's my first time seeing it. It's a pretty nice looking aircraft, actually. I always like the look of these dual engine. Actually, I really like the look of the aircraft. That shot there, the very final shot. Let me see if I can pause it. He fires off his rockets. That shot, oh, damn it. Well, this shot here, I really, really like. Look at the weird shapes of the wings. I don't know, something about it just gives me a boner. Anyways, we are pleased to present to you the Royal Air Force successor of the well-known Bristol Bowfighter. The Bristol, I have no fucking clue. That will arrive in Update 1.63 Desert Hunters in the designated B-1 bomber variant. It actually looks like it's got cannons or something there. I just now realized that. We are pleased to present to you the Royal Air Force successor of the well-known Bristol Bowfighter. The Bristol... Wait, we already read that. Yeah, it's the exact same thing there. The Bristol... Brigand, was a successor to the aging Bristol Bowfighter, a heavy two-engine fighter that was able to step into a wide range of combat roles, from night fighter, ground attack aircraft, to naval torpedo bomber. I really never used my Bowfighter for torpedo bombing thing. Does anybody remember back in the day when the Bowfighter was ridiculously OP? Like, if anybody remembers classic War Thunder, Bowfighter Mark 10, 6 50 caliber machine guns, 4 20 millimeter cannons, and rockets, plus the 30 caliber gunner seat. And this was back when the Hispanos were super OP, which they're kind of like that now that they've gotten air targets, but air targets don't have tracers, so it's hard to pinpoint where you're actually hitting. But holy shit, back in the day, guys, the Bowfighter Mark 10 was ridiculous, and it fucking turned on a dime. It was fast. It was durable. It was... If you think there is Russian bias now, well, you should have seen the British Bowfighter Mark 10 back in the day. You would have claimed British bias, because holy shit, I really wish it was like that. It's had many nerfs, and now it's still fun to fly, especially in arcade. Holy hell, I love to fly the Bowfighters in there. I think my favorite Bowfighter is still the Mark 10. I like the Mark 21, I believe, the Australian variant. I'm not sure if it's the Mark 21. The first Bowfighter you get is okay, but it's not fantastic. And in realistic battles, the Bowfighter kind of suffers. But if you get lucky and you don't get Germans hopping on your ass every 5 seconds, then you can actually make away with a pretty damn good match. I used to play the Bowfighter quite a bit in a squad way back in the day in when it was called Historical Battles. Anyways, the thing was developed during World War II, no shit, but came too late to see service or have any meaningful impact on the outcome of the war. It was later deployed during the Malayan Emergency. The Malayan Emergency. What is that? I'm going to do a Google search quick, because I've never heard of that. Alright, you learn something new every day, I guess. I just read the quick headline there that the Wikipedia provided for me. There's quite a bit of information, so I'll go into that later, though. But since I've never heard of that, it'd be interesting to read up on that later. The main idea behind producing a new type of multi-role heavy fighter was to simplify the production of logistics. The new thing reconstructed the tail of the existing Buckingham medium bomber. Okay, a vehicle I've never heard of. While aiming for higher speed and incorporating the implementation of newer technologies. The Thing, B-1 bomber variant, was powered by two Bristol Thing, 57 power plants, each generating a maximum continuous power of 2,165 horsepower, which allowed the aircraft to reach a maximum speed of 357 miles per hour, 574 kilometers an hour, at 16,500 feet, or 5,030 meters. The weight of the empty aircraft was slightly over 11 tons, and it was operated by a three-man crew. Three men. Okay. There you get to see the aircraft there, and what is going on here? What the fuck? The Thing is transforming. That's interesting there. I'll save that screenshot for later. Okay, here we go. Its main armament consisted of four forward-facing 20mm Hispano-Mark V cannons under the nose, and it could mount up to almost 2,000 pounds of bombs, or 16 unguided RP-3 rockets in different configurations. A total of 147 of these aircraft were built. The aircraft was decommissioned in 1958 and eventually replaced by both the de Havilland Hornet and the English Electric Canberra. Okay, so it's got your typical British payload, it's got your typical British armament, 20mm Hispano Mark V cannons, or just 20mm Hispano in general. Some of them are Mark II, some of them are Mark IVs, you know, I'm sure there's a Mark IV in there, maybe there's not, I don't know, I've got my mind on other things right now. But what aircraft these days does the British get in the game that isn't armed with 420mm cannons? And that's not a bad thing at all. In fact, it's really fucking awesome. Although, it's happens so frequently that when they get something that is not armed with 420mm cannons, or a mixture of them, it's like, whoa, this is British? I mean, you know, half the aircraft in the game for the British... texture. All you gotta do is you skip past tier 1 and 2 and start looking at what the cannons, armaments are in the aircraft. You see, 420mm, 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 220mm! And then another variant of it is a 420mm, 420mm. And some of them have 420mm plus machine guns, so you know, it's like, wow. And that's not a bad thing, that's actually really, really good, and it's pretty damn deadly given that the aircraft is up to snuff. So it will serve as a stately replacement for the Bristol Wolf Fighter in your lineup. Maybe for higher tiers, but, I mean, Bowfighter, it's going to take a lot to beat that, because I love the Bowfighter. It will be located at Tier 4. Okay, yeah, of course it's going to outweigh the Bowfighter then for me. In the British Heavy Fighter line, right after the Mosquito, and will be... Whoa. What Mosquito, my friend? What Mosquito will it be after? No, it doesn't. No, you can't say, they just said Mosquito, so it must mean that it'll be after both of them. Then plural, because there are two Mosquitoes in the game, right? What Mosquito? Yeah, this is very important, because I already have the entire Heavy Fighter line ground out. It's very important to know which one it comes after, because it matters. Wait, do I? Where does the Heavy Fighter line for the British end? Or not Heavy Fighter, the Heavy Fighter. Where does that end? Does that go into the Attacker Jet? Or is that a different line? The Attacker Jet is in the line with the new set of aircraft that we got a couple updates ago. So, and then next to that, and then you got the Bombers, so the Mosquito... So there is no Jets in the Heavy Fighter line, is there? So this would probably be the last thing, the top thing in that tech line. Which would mean I could just start grinding it right away. I think. Unless I'm mistaken and missing an aircraft. It will be researchable for all players in the game. So it's not a premium. The premium will be the other thing. The Hudson, I think. That's going to be the premium for the British. Hopefully we get something on that, because I'm actually interested in that too. Even though it looks pretty strange. As in the history, our players will be able to utilize the full potential of this aircraft, either for close ground support, which is probably what I will be using it for, as a dive bomber, that too, heavy attacker, probably not so much for me in realistic, but maybe in arcade, or very soon against naval forces. And what they mean there is fishing boats. While its maximum top speed and maneuverability might not be suited for battle designated fighter aircraft, it is a good all-around and will serve you in combined battles. I know, you know, if it's anything like the bow fighter, like a beefed up bow fighter, it's gonna be good in all combat stations. The bow fighter, even the Mark 10, you know, it's not fantastic against ground units. The rockets, it's just the wings are so hard to launch any rockets and get good accurate gunfire. But I mean, it gets MGs and it gets cannons. This won't have MGs or a gunner, I don't think, but it's gonna have cannons, and those cannons can shred up quite a bit of the light targets. And plus, I mean, look at all the rockets it gets. Fucking hell, it gets freaking 16 rockets this thing is going to be able to carry. And look, this screenshot here shows 16 rockets and a bomb. So that means this thing is going to be able to carry rockets and bombs. That's going to be pretty good for ground attack missions. And I mean, load up your cannons with air target rounds, launch your rockets, drop your bombs on a few ground targets, maybe use a bit of your cannon ammo to soften up some of the ground target AAA, maybe some light units, and then pull up and engage in some low-flying aircraft. Intercept enemy bombers, enemy attackers that are low, or maybe try and go full-on heavy fighter mode and climb. I see some bow fighters doing that in realistic battles, and they tend to die. But I have seen, way in the past, I have seen bow fighters do pretty damn well in realistic battles. Click the tray icon to restore Bandicamp. Bandicamp's still here, my friend. It's up here in the corner. Fucking dumbass. The Bristol thing does not resemble any unique design that wasn't already seen elsewhere. Really? Okay. And did not play any pivotal role during the war, but rather cleared the path for implementation of more advanced technologies and is a worthy replacement for the Bowfighter for Tier 4 combined battles. Enjoy. Now, what if you're not playing combined battles? Well, combined player battles, I guess I should say. Then you're screwed. You're screwed, my friend. That's what's going to happen. Let's see what the comments are going on here. Everybody seems to be mostly in support of it. Does this mean we will have missions where we need to bomb or rocket structures, not just bases and vehicles? Ooh, I like this. I like this guy's comment. Let's see. All answers, two. Lots of maps have pillboxes, ships, area targets, bridges, and many other elements that can be destroyed by bombs and rockets. Good job for answering his question, mate. I don't know why it says he had two answers. He's got one answer and two replies, and these aren't even an answer. This isn't an answer. Why did I say he's got two answers? No, he's got zero answers to his question here. Interesting. Let's see. I want to check the next page. I just want to see if there's anybody against it, and I want to see why. I don't see any problems with it. Designate them as attackers. They must be designated as freaking heavy fighters in the game. Yeah, I've seen a lot of people want this in the game. I want this in the game too. The Whirlwind, I think that would be a nice addition. I don't know what Gaijin's reason is for not putting it in yet, because it's, according to a lot of people, it's an aircraft that could have been added ages ago. And while I don't know too much about it, I do know that it would be a good addition, but I don't know why they haven't put it in yet. It has been an aircraft that could be around, according to people, for a long time now. I don't know, Gaijin probably has their reasons, but hey, you know what? I'm not disappointed with this aircraft that we're getting. It looks fun. I think I would like to fly this thing at some point in realistic battles, especially. I think this could become one of my favorite attacker aircraft, given that I actually get a chance to do some attacking missions with it. There's a lot of attacker aircraft in the game that you'll get the same map over and over again, and the map is terrible for ground attack, and you just keep getting intercepted by every single enemy fighter every single time. Even if you just climb around the side of the map or fly super low around the side of the map, doesn't matter, you always get intercepted, and there's not enough ground targets or not enough variety to attack. I'm not going to name the maps, but I think Preparation H is probably the... Well, you just said you weren't going to name the maps. Shit. Preparation H for British side is fantastic. You're going to get intercepted every single time. American side... Well, I guess it's not really American side, is it? No, the U.S. side is fantastic. The British side is the difficult one. I could go into this later, but the reason that that map works so much less with ground attack than any other map is because, well, the ground area, because it's a fucking island or some shit, it's so thin and narrow, and the airfields are right there and right there, so everybody can meet up. You can't just fly out to the edge of the map and turn in. Doesn't matter, because where all the ground targets are in the middle. They are on this thin layer of map. And the United States, they get pillboxes and they get stationary targets, light AA, heavy AA, artillery positions, and all this stuff they can just clean up. I can easily go on that map, zoom in, and within 5 seconds there's already multiple Spitfires on my ass. But I can rack up a 20-plus ground kill streak there, given that I have MGs. British, fuck. There's columns of vehicles. It's much harder for the British to actually perform ground attack because... Well, 20mm cannons can't destroy medium tanks anymore. And the only thing you can do is maybe slop up a few light vehicles. Armored cars, maybe the half-tracks that are driving around, maybe some of the light AA at the enemy bases. And that's when you're being intercepted by P-51s and P-47s and F-82s and shit. And you even have B-17s down there chasing after you. Remember that video clip I uploaded ages ago, like a couple years ago, where I was in the Lancaster? And there was a B-17 chasing me, and I blew it up with my Lancaster. I don't know how many people... That was back when I didn't have any subscribers. But that video is somewhere in the ancient parts of my channel, and it was hilarious. I just blew up the B-17 exploded from my 30 cals. It was hilarious.